biggest ship afloat nears the end of her Shakedown cruise. The mighty carrier Enterprise, the world's first nuclear-powered aircraft carrier, undergoes intensive aerial and shipboard operations before being rated for combat readiness of her crew, ship, and airplane sections. Equipped with aircraft designed for specialized functions, the Big E carries a punch that has never been approached by any other fighting ship. Her flight deck is nearly 4.5 acres, and she can handle speedy jet planes with ease. Unless costs can be reduced, the Enterprise is likely to be the last nuclear carrier. She cost a whopping $444 million. Crewmen say the 85,000 tons of the Big E handle like a speedboat. She's an awesome ship. Come to the fair, a preview, the ultra-modern way. This radical monorail train will carry visitors to Century 21, the Seattle World's Fair that is expected to draw 10 million visitors during its six-month run. An $80 million production, the Great Exposition is laid out on 74 acres in the shadow of Queen Anne Hill, and many of the buildings will be permanent fixtures in Seattle when the fair closes. A giant 60 by 17 foot ceramic mural will be one of the first things to greet the visitor, who will see exhibits sponsored by 27 foreign nations. A feature display will be homes of the future loaded with labor-saving devices. There's an air of organized confusion as work is rushed to completion for the opening. The theme of the fair is set by the Space Needle, a 600 foot tower that is flanked by speedy elevators. They carry you to a 4-story disc atop the minaret, where you can wine and dine, or just look. The disc makes one complete revolution each hour. The view of Seattle from the top is breathtaking, so how's about it? See you at the fair. Now there's aid from Latin America. Dr. Jose Bonilla Attilis, Foreign Minister of the Dominican Republic, presents Mr. Kennedy with an elaborately carved rocking chair made from 400-year-old mahogany taken from a Dominican castle. The new rocker is taken on a trial run by the president, who hasn't committed himself on whether it will swing into daily use. Mr. Racing, the master, is saying goodbye to the king of sports. Eddie Arcaro announces his retirement after 30 years of booting them home. There's an air of sadness as he cleans out his jockey room locker for the last time. 46 years old, Eddie rode 4,700 winners, and those successful drives down the home stretch won purses amounting to $30 million. A jockey gets 10%, so figure it out. He won 5 Kentucky Derbies, and with Whirlaway and Citation, won the Triple Crown, the top 3 races for 3-year-olds. So now, farewell. Gone is the roar of the crowd. Gone is the thrill of the winner's circle. Though racing silks may fade, Eddie will be remembered long by racing fans. Years ago, Cuba contrasted radically from what it is today. Then they were celebrating the 42nd anniversary of their independence from Spanish rule. Even under a dictator, the people enjoyed more freedom than they do under the tyrant who rules today. There was a laughter and gaiety that no longer exists. It was a good baseball year, and the Detroit Tigers were sharpening their claws in spring training at Lakeland, Florida. They had men like Cochran, Walker, Simmons, and Greenberg. Big guns to spark a pretty successful season. They didn't make the World Series, but pitchers like Schoolboy Rowe kept them in the running. Hank Greenberg and Mickey Cochran made the Hall of Fame. The St. Louis Cardinals ran behind the New York Giants for first place, despite Daffy Dean and Lon Wernicke, two of the season's best hurlers. They also had the Fordham Flash, Frankie Frisch, and other speed merchants. Dizzy Dean did his own spring training.
Have you signed up yet? No, I haven't signed my contract this year yet, and don't expect to unless the Cardinals pay me $50,000. If I'm worth $400,000 to the ball club, I'm at least worth $50,000 to myself.
Sit-down strikes were the mood of the day after the auto workers won a contract by staying in their plants. In Joliet, Illinois, beer customers also sat firmly on their rights. They planted themselves in this tavern and drank, you'll excuse the expression, water, in protest over a rise in the price of beer. They helped themselves to the free lunch, too, but found the pretzels a little dry to wash down with, oh, you know what. Needless to say, the customers lost their strike. Speaking of the cup that cheers, the Baltimore Country Club came up with an added fillip to make the long trek to the 18th hole more enticing. When the duffer sliced, hooked, and cursed his way to the final hole, he found solace on a 19th hole. He could have topped his tee shots, lived in the rough, and missed 6-inch putts. But once he arrived here, he could call his shots, a shot of this or a shot of that. Bar golf almost replaced par golf.